like, you know, God is working very mysterious way. Probably this is one of the mysterious ways he's working. He's trying to take things one step at a time, you know? And I was like, okay, nothing. I wasn't very worried or very, you know, concerned. I was like, it'll play out fine, you know? Just need to trust God, you know? It'll work out fine. And then, about 2 weeks ago, I got the reply from both schools that they were only going to substitute my studies there. They're going to pay like, I think 50% of the tuition fees only. Which means in a year I have about like 30,000, you know, to cover the rest. And I was more, I wasn't just worried about, you know, the cost of living there or the remaining expenses. But I was worried is how am I going to reflect this on my visa to get my visa approved? Because we have to show that, you know, we have all these funds to study over here, then we get our visa approved. And I was worried about that because even if I could find the funds later on to survive, but how am I going to show it now, you know, to get my visa approved? And that was a concern. And I was thinking like, you know, I can't go back home and ask people back home to help because our exchange rate is 3.6. And that's crazy. It's like getting 100,000 ringgit from Malaysia, asking someone for 100,000 ringgit Malaysia, that's the price of a apartment in Malaysia. And I was like, no, that's difficult, you know? That's not an option. So I was thinking, you know, probably look around, get someone, you know, to be gracious enough to produce a bank account statement and just get the visa through and then I'll worry about the rest later. I was praying and I talked to Professor Seow and you know Professor Seow has been very gracious to me, you know, helping me and when he heard, and the one thing about Professor Seow is this, he never said anything is impossible. Everything is possible for him. And so I went to him and said, you know what, that's the best person someone who never say it's impossible. So I went and talked to him and for once he looked at me and said, you know what? That's a really big amount. Because there were 2 years over there. And he said, I don't know how I can help you with this. For once he's being so negative and I was like, God, this is not what I need at this point. You know, if anything I really need is at least some sort of encouragement from someone that is possible. You know, that we'll see what are the options we have. And I from the Assemblies of God and I called the counselor down in Atlanta to ask if there's jobs available, if there's a way that I could serve in the church and have my study somehow, you know, they could give me some substantial amount to help out in the fundings and things like that. Everything was just a closed door. Everyone said, you know what, we don't really have much funds, we can do that. I tried, I went down South Street, I talked with some pastors on in the churches that I know, I discussed with them. Everything didn't seem good, you know? It was like no hope. And then I remembered, I took out the letter from Emery and I saw the date. That is way past the date I'm supposed to reply the whether I'm coming in. Which means, bye-bye, option number one. Now I left with Vanderbilt. And Vanderbilt I have until end of April. I was like, it's just 2 more weeks. Why am I going to find 30,000 in 2 more weeks? It's impossible. I'm like, no, God, not now. So, last week when I came and preached, I remember telling, you know, about talking about faith, but in me I was so discouraged. I was like, it's like, I think I preach about, you know, scattering seed, right? I preach about scattering seed and there'll be some seed fall on rocky ground, some seed fall on the good tawny ground and things like that, and some fall on the good ground. And I pointed out that for all the bad ground, the seed, the word seed that was used is used in the singular, right? And for the seed that fell on the good ground, it was a plural of seeds, which means lot, not just one, but a lot, I would say, plural form of dead ends and fat soil and whatever they bear. And as I preached, I was like, God, I need the seeds, not the seed. Help me to see, to learn from my own message. I was feeling so down last week. I was thinking, how in the world, once emperor is gone, that's it. Even though I was accepted, even though I got a 50% scholarship, I have to turn all of it down, and that's it. That's the end of it. Then this week, just on Thursday, someone in the campus, on campus, just walked up to me. Someone on campus, someone I totally didn't expect. It's not a faculty, it's not a lecturer, it's not someone you would ever expect. But I knew him. I good friends. But he's working on campus. He's an elderly gentleman, very nice gentleman. He was talking to me, asking me about my further studies, and I'm just really telling him, like, no, I'll go. I got accepted. Scholarship is not good. I have 2 more weeks to decide, and then that's it. That's all I told him. And then he was like, how much is left? Can I say, it's a huge amount. It's like 30K, man. So what do you need? I say, are you asking me what do I need? I say, I need to get my visa approved. Then I can come back and study. And I need to show I have this amount. In 2 weeks time, I have to prove that I have this amount to get my visa approved so I can come back and study. And he says, I can do that for you. And I was like, that's nice of you. You know, and in my mind, I was just thinking, he was just going to give me an account statement. And I was like, that's what I need for the first step, you know? Okay, God is answering my prayer. And then I went back to my room, I went back to my dorm. I was grateful, but not like, you know, I had so much to worry about. Now I'm thinking, okay, now I can come back to America, but how am I going to find 30,000 to survive the entire year and study at the same time? It's impossible. I only have 20 hours to work. I'm only given 20 hours to work, and I don't know, that only will earn me about 7,000 a year, and that is nothing compared to, you know, 30,000. So I was like, is it wise to actually just get the visa approved and come back? Is that wise? I was asking myself, or should I just wait? And I went the next day on Friday. The person came up to me again and said, remember the time when I had problems with my leg and you came by to help me out in the mail room? He has his leg amputated. And he said, you came by the mail room and helped me, and then you had class. And you ran off for class, but you sent someone else to take care of me that day. And then in between your breaks, you came back to the mail room to check on me if everything was alright. And through the night, you actually texted me and asked me, you know, how's my leg, how's the pain and things like that. He said, you know what? I was really touched. And he said, I remember the time when, you know, at 4:30 we off work from the mail room and everyone would just leave the mail room and say, I remember the days when I had problems with my leg. You stood there and you waited for me to lock up and you watched me enter the car and before you left. See, you, it was different. And he said, I want to do something substantial for you. He said, I'm covering everything for your 2 years. He's getting a full scholarship. He's basically getting a full scholarship. I looked at him. I didn't know what to say. All I could say is that, God, you got me this time. I was like thinking there's no way out. It's 2 weeks. And I said, God, don't ever play this game ever again. It's too risky. It's frightening. Just 2 weeks to find 30,000. Don't do that again. But thank God. But thank you, Jesus. It worked out. And you know, I called Emily and said, I'm sorry it's past the deadline, but this is my first choice. I really want to come into Emory. Is it possible? Because I was looking for fundings and things like that. Is it possible that you still could accept my reply, although it's late, made by 2 weeks? And then they said, well, just send me everything to get your visa. Now, When I prepared this sermon, I was dead in my doubts. I remember the time when I was dead in my doubts, I was dead in my discouragement, I was dead in the beginning. But don't lose hope. There is always an even now moment. I remember that at a point when everything was just, you know, dead, and I remember walking to the chapel one day. It was early in the morning, no chapel, I walked in, I couldn't sleep the whole night, I walked into the chapel. I couldn't even pray. I just sat down there in the pews, the last row. This chapel has really nice acoustics. You can just speak things out loud in echoes. And I remember saying this, that God, make a way when there is seem to be no way. And that was the only thing I could say. I couldn't pray a prayer. I couldn't even tell God what was going on, what was the thing I need. Because everything seems so impossible. It seems like, you know, God wouldn't hear it. It's too big. And all I said was, God, make a way. And yesterday when I prepared this message, it wasn't just a message that I'm just going to preach to you, but it's something that I can tell you that is true, that God knows you, and He'll make a way. God bless you. And bless them, and just pray. Yeah.